Hey y'all, hey. I'm sorry, y'all know it's about a 10-second delay between YouTube and StreamYard, and child, I was still over here shaking my pants pockets. All right. Well, welcome everyone back to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. You guys could be anywhere else, but you're here spreading the legs on another novel in the Speakeasy with me. So welcome. Y'all show my moderator, Love Jones, please, a little love and affection moving in the right direction. And please make sure that you like the video on your way in. If you haven't already, which I'm not sure why you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe to the channel. It's a good time over here, honey. We be kikiing and cackling, and sometimes we get a little pissed off with these characters in these novels, but it's a good time regardless, all right? Make sure after you subscribe that you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with all that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. All right, so let me see who's here, child. So I can acknowledge everybody, because otherwise y'all get to throwing drinks and shit if I don't say hey to y'all. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Welcome back, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. And the first sipper and speaker in the building is Honestly Kay. Welcome, darling. Happy hump day to you. I appreciate you being here, darling. Welcome, welcome. Not you click so fast. You ain't break a nail, did you? And the second sipper and speaker through the door is Naquetta Faulkner. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. Man, I got out of the other book I was listening to so fast. Ah, she said, I've been listening to your other reads every day. Oh, thank you. Welcome, darling. Happy hump day to you. And thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. All right, y'all. So listen. Today, let me get my time stamp, child. Y'all know if I don't, it's going to be a mess. I won't even be able to let the people know where I stop talking and the book starts. All right, today we're reading Butterfly 2 by Ashley Antoinette. I was bullied into going back to this series, so this is where we are. All right, the synopsis reads, Morgan Atkins is used to losing, but losing Messiah Williams was the most tragic of them all. Surely, after Messiah, no other man could compare. Settling with Sebastian Fredrick didn't seem like such an impossible task. He treated her well enough, he accepted her children, and he offered her entrance into a well-connected world. There was only one problem. He wanted to change her into someone else. The rules that went along with his lifestyle suffocated her, and when Morgan reconnected with Messiah's crew, she no longer wanted to play by Bash's rules. When she falls in love with Messiah's best friend, Ahmeek Harris, she knows she's headed for trouble. His presence heals her in a way that no man has ever been able to do before. Their love affair is electric. Morgan is uncertain about many things, but one thing she's sure of is that she can't let this feeling go. She goes out on a limb and risks it all just to be with Meek. But when Messiah reveals that he's still alive, the battle for one girl's heart just may lead to the demise of them all. She can only be queen to one man. Which one has the true key to her heart? Can Messiah make up for his mistakes, or is it too late to save what they once had? Is Ahmeek a rebound, or does he offer her something more? Does Bash even stand a chance? This second installment of the Butterfly series will leave you breathless. All right, so there you have it. All right, thanks for coming out. We'll see y'all next week. No, just I'm just playing. All right, so let me get my bearings here and grab my timestamp, and we can get started, child. Because listen, y'all want to know just as badly as I do how this is going to happen. Prologue. The fog was dense as Messiah maneuvered his car through the state park. Now here's Messiah back on the scene. I'm mad about it. He should have stayed dead. I know that sounds harsh, but if you've been here, y'all know I want her to be with Meek. Meeky, for short. All right. The sun had barely risen. Orange and purple painted the sky as life began to awaken. He gripped the steering wheel with one hand and kept his other on the pistol in his lap. He knew there was no point in carrying it. He wouldn't use it. Not on this day. Not on this man. He had tried before to curl a trigger to this target, but had failed. He wasn't stupid enough to make the attempt again. He saw the red taillights to a silver F-150 and then saw Ethic as the driver's door opened. Stern and moody, Ethic appeared as he always did, intolerant, intimidating. He went to the bed of the truck and released the gate. He began to unload buckets and fishing poles and bait from the back. "Ish it, man," Messiah mumbled as he pulled in behind the truck. Messiah knew better than to exit the car with his pistol. He stored it under his seat, climbed out, slamming the door. "It's 6 a.m., man. We couldn't do this at no better time?" Messiah asked as he frowned. "Fish bite best at dawn," Ethic stated. Messiah hated the skeptical eye Ethic looked at him with. It was a new light. Ethic had never looked at him with such mistrust 2 years ago. It made Messiah feel like he wore his betrayal on his forehead. "Well, you do, bastard. You was trying to kill him. And for what? All right." A scarlet letter of disdain that he feared he would never be able to shake. "Grab that bait," Ethic instructed. Messiah snatched up the bucket and followed Ethic down the dock to the boat that sat tied to the end. "You bought a boat?" Messiah asked. "Well, Lonnie, she wanted one. Something to take the kids out on. She picked this motherfucker out and it just sits. So I took up fishing to justify the expense," Ethic said, as he climbed aboard. It was a beautiful vessel with a bar, two berths for sleeping, and living space beneath. "You'll do anything for her, huh, OG?" Messiah asked. "Whatever she asks, whenever she asks. That's my job, to anticipate her needs before she even knows she needs something. I'm her man, so that's my role. She'll never want for anything with me, not even attention, not even time. Money is cool, but the things I can't buy, she appreciates most. It's why I buy her everything else, too, because she don't give a fuck about it." Messiah didn't know what to say. He hoped to have something like that one day. Even his hope for it was progress, because there was a time when Messiah didn't want that type of connection with another human being at all. Now he craved it. Now he yearned for it with Mo. Damn, how Messiah Williams wanted to buy Morgan Atkins a boat. Ethic got in the captain's seat and the motor came alive, chopping up the water beneath them. They didn't speak as Ethic sailed away from the shore. Messiah took a seat at the aft, leaning over onto his knees, hands rubbing as he held his head low. He was lost, completely drowned in his own thoughts. He didn't even realize how far out they'd gotten until he heard Ethic cut the engine. He looked around as Ethic lowered the anchor. "You know why we came out here?" Ethic asked. Messiah bit into his bottom lip and nodded. "You're trying to decide if I'm going to stay out here," he answered. He had known the moment he had seen the boat. They could have fished from the bridge. Ethic had taken him out for tranquility. It was a perfect morning to commit a murder, and the lake was a suitable resting place. Messiah was on thin ice. He knew it. And still, he willingly joined Ethic on this early morning boat ride. It would either be his funeral procession or his walk of redemption. Ethic would decide which. There was no avoiding it. "You're well? Feeling all right?" Ethic broke the silence as he turned his chair to face Messiah. "I'm breathing," Messiah answered. "For now." An awkward silence. Then a scoff of acknowledgement from Ethic and more silence as Ethic stood. He grabbed the poles and the bucket of bait before going to the edge of the boat. He sat, feet thrown casually over the side as he cast a reel into the dark waters below. "Grab a stick. Let me teach you how to catch your meal, Messiah." Messiah grabbed a fishing pole and sat beside Ethic about a yard away. "Alani is my meal. She fills me, nourishes me. I had to hunt her because a real woman knows how to evade you. They know how to maintain some control in their lives. It's a must they retain some governance over themselves. So I had to figure out how to get her to think that submitting to me was a choice and not dominance. If she thought I was trying to conquer her, she would buck. She would go against what I wanted and the role I needed her to fill. So I hunted that. I caught that. Her heart, you know, hit every target with precision. Her heart, her body, her mind. Showed her a nigga could be her suitor. I proved to her over and over again that I could keep her safe, not just physically, but mentally and emotionally. By the time she even realized the game, she was mine. Now she can't live without a nigga. Can't breathe without me. Don't sleep right without me. Body don't react to nobody but me. I caught my meal. She fed me, put everything in my belly that was needed to make me feel like a man. And that pussy, my nigga. Ethic shook his head and Messiah snickered. Ethic didn't share details like that, and Messiah hiked his brows in surprise. Were? Messiah asked. Messiah was surprised when he saw a coy grin pull at the corners of Ethic's lips. He nodded. A lucky man, young. I never would have fucking thought. You never will think about that. I'll pluck the sense from your fucking head before I ever let you look at her and think anything of the fucking sorts, Ethic snickered. Messiah grinned. Gotta lay bait for Mo. That's so tempting. She can't do shit else but bite, Ethic said. You gotta feel good to her, Messiah. You gotta feel safe for her. You gotta look nourishing. You want her to submit and open every part of her. You gotta secure her. Throw out your bait to catch a queen. A queen is gonna pick the safest kingdom. Your bait is the kingdom you build. The last name you're offering, the history behind it. Messiah's chest locked. It protested inside him. I can't help who I am. She'll never want that. Blood to the nigga that rocked her entire world. She won't love that. She don't want no parts of me. My Zahn wasn't your brother, Ethic interrupted. Messiah's heart stilled. All his waters ran dry. His throat closed. His blood thickened. His stomach hollowed. Ethic's words attacked him, exploding in his mind like a mental bomb. The headache and heartache they caused felt cruel because no way could the words be true. I wish that was Bond, OG, but when have you ever known me to say anything just to say it? He's not your blood. He was Bookie's lover, maybe. I don't know, man. The shit is so fucking twisted. Your father had some preferences, some demons. Ethic paused, trying to choose his words carefully for Messiah's sake, because while Mizan was no longer attached to Messiah, Bookie was. Bookie had changed him, had hurt him. Don't call that nigga my daddy. He ain't that. He didn't raise shit. I see how you are with Easy, how you guide him, teach him, even when he do something wrong and you gotta get in his ass. You're stern, but you easy with homie too. You walk real light on his heart, even when you gotta be the bad guy. I see that between you and him. That's fatherhood. That's the only way of being a father I will ever acknowledge. What he did, who he was, that shit ain't. Messiah stopped speaking and lowered his head, shaking it in shame. Some niggas just got the devil in them. What he did to you and young boys before you, I'm sorry about that. I know it turned you cold. You never really had a chance, Messiah. And if I had known earlier, if you had told me, I mean, if I had even the smallest clue of what was happening, I would have eliminated that nigga. I would have hit him in the middle and bled that nigga slow. Ethic said the words so casually that they sent chills down Messiah's spine. He knew it wasn't an empty threat. There was no need to be loud when you meant what you said. Big facts. Messiah was surprised Ethic had spoken the words at all. So often a threat was eliminated without warning because Ethic didn't grandstand. He was a murderer, plain and simple. I couldn't tell nobody that, Messiah stated. Not even you, especially not you. I believe he did the same to Mizan, but the abuse turned into something else, something sick. Some fucking Stockholm shit that I don't think anyone can ever understand because the only people who can explain it are no longer breathing. They were twisted, but I have proof that Mizan was not your blood. You're not related to the man that ruined Mo's childhood, and it don't matter that Bookie was yours biologically. I chose you a long time ago, Messiah. I don't know if you're like my son or my brother or a little bit of both, but you're mine. The shit you did cut deep. I ain't slept right since the night you told me who you were. Ain't breathe right. I lost something that day. Mo lost everything that day, but you not being my Zahn's brother, that'll mean something to her. It'll give you a chance. You only gonna get one shot with her, though. I won't let you mess her over again. You gotta come right. You gotta have your shit together, Messiah. None of that half-ass little boy shit you carrying around on the inside. You couldn't help your past. Couldn't control it. Couldn't do anything to stop the chaos. You can control what happens next, though. You're not that little boy anymore, you understand? Messiah nodded and sniffed away the overwhelming emotion that watered his eyes. He flicked his nose, then squeezed the bridge of it. Ethic stared out at the water as Messiah tried to control the onslaught of trauma that plagued him. You cross me again, and I won't hesitate, Ethic stated. You even breathe wrong, and Messiah's grief was palpable. And Ethic stopped the threat because he realized Messiah knew what was at stake. He put a hand on Messiah's shoulder. He gave it a hard squeeze and then handed him the fishing pole. What the fuck I'm supposed to do with this, big homie? Wifey done turned you into an old-ass man, Messiah said. Ethic chuckled and nodded as he reached into a jacket pocket, retrieving an expertly rolled blunt. Old as fuck, and she gonna probably bitch up a storm when she smells this shit on me, but the least I can do is blow one with you. I mean, she can make an exception considering I got cancer and all, Messiah said, as Ethic sparked the blunt. That might be the only thing that stop her from putting me on the couch, Ethic snickered. Messiah watched Ethic pull the smoke into his lungs, cheeks puffing, and then he blew it into the air. He passed the blunt. Shit must be nice, Messiah said as he hit the weed. I want that. With Mo, Shorty Doo-Wopka put me on the couch every night as long as she let me come home. I need you to keep your distance, Messiah. You can't pop up on her without warning. I need to talk to her first. Mo's fragile. She can't take a lot. You focus on getting you together, and I'll figure out how to let her know you're back. Hell, that you're alive at all. She went through a hard time when you left. You got to be careful with the way you come back into her life. I just want to be here, man, whatever it takes. Messiah passed the blunt back to Ethic, and Ethic nodded as if he was settling things in his head. I love you, kid. More fuck-ups, Ethic stated. Messiah's eyes burned. To have forgiveness and love after what he'd done, he hadn't expected to receive that much. It was a gift he had never received, a gift he didn't deserve. He couldn't even respond with words because he was afraid he would lose it. The sudden tug on his line startled him, distracting him. A friendly shift of focus from God right when it was needed, right when the vulnerability was making two of his most difficult children uncomfortable. A fish had taken the bait. Oh, shit, what I do? Messiah asked. Start reeling, Ethic said. Messiah stood, slightly panicked, as he pulled in the fish. Yo, this motherfucker ain't coming up, Messiah shouted. It was one of very few times in his life that he felt carefree. It felt easy, like nothing outside of this interaction mattered, like Ethic was indeed his father, and as long as he had him, he knew he would be okay. Ethic would never know how much he meant to Messiah because Messiah would never tell him. Messiah whirled the fishing pole until a small fish came flopping out of the water. Yo, this little motherfucker got heart, Messiah said, holding up the end of the line. Ethic hollered as he stood to his feet. Throw it back, man. Sometimes you catch something just to let it go. When it's for you, you'll know it. That ain't your catch. And that's the end of the prologue. Okay. I'm mad. So I'm just going to have to deal with that. I don't even know how I feel. I'm mad. That's how I feel. I feel angry. I do. Because I don't want Messiah back. He need to get the fuck out of here. Yeah, I need him to go. I don't like it. Welcome, Soul Ebony G. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Yeah, I don't like Messiah. That's some bullshit. I feel some type of way about it. I do. I thought I saw somebody else pop in here, but maybe I was mistaken. Did I miss somebody? Y'all better say something before I go back. I think, let me keep scrolling. There you go. Hey, Kim Cash. Welcome, darling. Happy hump day to you. Thank you so much for being here. Yeah, man. Listen, I wanted Messiah to stay dead. I want her to be with Meek. I feel like she may love Meek more than she loved Messiah because, I mean, hey, you know what I'm saying? I got you, Kim Cash. Hey, Shanae. Happy hump day, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. She talking about, yo, yo, yo. I got you, boo. I got you. I was trying to make sure I got everybody. Yeah, I don't know how I'm going to feel about this book. This is about to be some shit. I can feel it already. All right, let me, oh, man. I don't even know. I just feel some type of way. Thank goodness for coffee and water because I have a feeling I'm about to be upset. Chapter 1. Ahmeek sat in the car, listening to the hum of his engine as it ticked to a stop. Crickets serenaded the night air. The green numbers on his console read 11:24 p.m. It had taken him 2 hours to get to her, and he had been sitting there, engrossed in thought for half an hour longer. He knew she was waiting, but his conscience had him glued to his seat. His heart thundered in his chest as he finessed his beard, mind zoned out as his thoughts swarmed him. He rested against the headrest. He had to take a beat. He had to pause, to think. He was in deep. He was drowning in Morgan Atkins, and neither of them wanted to be saved. They hadn't even taken a moment to come up for air. What they were doing was reckless. His heart was involved. Hers had been from the start, and he didn't want to fumble, his or hers. He didn't want to ugly up something that had been beautiful thus far. He felt like turning around because once he got out of the car, he would have to take it all the way. She had called him, requested his presence in the middle of the night. There was only one thing she could have wanted, but now he questioned if he should oblige. Conflict swirled in his chest. He saw her legs first as she descended the steps, heels at midnight, silk boy shorts, and the tiniest silk spaghetti strap negligee. The color was the same as her skin. He could barely tell that she had anything on at all. Damn, he whispered. Morgan Atkins was beautiful. Ass for days, thighs that trembled and full breasts that bounced with every step. Flashes of his lips around her areola as he palmed them entered his mind. They had just done this. She had just called him for rescue days before, and he had dropped everything to get to her, to save her. He had explored her depths just hours ago. Not even a full day had passed, and already she needed him again. It scared him. This was becoming a need. It was becoming serious, and his heart pounded. He had witnessed this pool. He had seen Messiah get lost in it. Like a black hole, Morgan had sucked him in. Now he understood. Now that it was him. Now that his mind was telling him to cut the shit off. But his heart was laughing at the request. He got it. She was irresistible. He was gangster, but she was godly. She called the shots. She was the coach, and she was making him put up 1,000 shots. Meek was a fucking shooter. 3 points all net. A franchise player. His dick jumped. Ahmeek couldn't do anything but shake his head and appreciate the sight as she folded her arms across her chest, forcing the mounds of her flesh to peek as she walked to his side of the car. She pulled open the door. Are you going to sit out here all night? He switched off the ignition and turned sideways, placing his feet to the concrete and leaning elbows to knees. He snapped his eyes closed. Air filled his lungs. One hand against his strong thigh, he braced himself before looking up. He knew when he looked at her, she would hypnotize him. Morgan Atkins stood in front of him. Did they give you a hard time at the gate? She asked. She was fucking phenomenal. Long hair, curly and slightly damp from the shower she'd taken. Face bare, eyes as dark as night. Nah, they didn't, he answered. Are you giving yourself a hard time, she asked. He bit his bottom lip and nodded, hanging his head. His turmoil hung on his shoulders. The guilt of his attraction to her weighed on him, but she had called, and when the queen summoned, you answered. You're fucking me up, Mo. I'm trying here. Morgan placed a hand on the top of his head, and he placed a hand to her stomach, fingers balling the fabric of her tiny camisole in his hands as she traced the pattern of his waves. You know where you're going to end up, so let's just stop feeling guilty about it, she whispered. You got to understand, love. He pushed and shook his head. The shit I want to do, we've already done, she reminded. I love new shit, more shit, Meek shit. Morgan's entire body came alive. Her face turned red. She had heard the stories, him fucking bitches until they lost their minds. That stalker nigga dick. That bust his windows out his car, dick. That put his tags in your name, dick. That let him flip your income tax return, dick. She wanted it so bad that her nipples tightened, screaming for attention. Mo grabbed one hand with both of hers and pulled him to his feet, backpedaling until he stood and followed her. His stomach hollowed. His head was all over the place. Morgan and Ahmeek. Nobody could have predicted this. If anyone had ever suggested it, he would have smacked the shit out of niggas. But here he was. Here they were. And it was more than sex. It was more than physical. You have to be careful with that girl, Meeky. It's not right. It's not wrong either. It just is. The two of you are in denial if you think this is friendship. This is love and the stakes are high. You be extremely careful with how you handle this with her. She's been broken before. Women don't come back the same and someone's going to end up hurt. His mother's words rang in his mind. It was the warning that made him think maybe, just maybe, this wasn't such a great idea. I don't plan on doing no hurting, Ma, he had said. You need to worry about her hurting you. She's not one of them little jump-offs you used to running around here with. She got the leverage, son. She's gonna eat you alive. They were both silent as he followed her up the stairs. The way her body reacted to movement was incredible. Little Morgan wasn't quite little Morgan anymore. She had filled out, mentally and physically, and she had ordered him up like she was picking up the phone to request a meal. She wanted Dick, extra large with a side of finesse. Morgan was amazing. She took all of him. She didn't run. Women ran from him. When he hit the bottom, they bolted. Morgan took it and called his name, her sultry voice screaming that shit like she was in another world. He shook his head. Maybe his mother was right. She was going to eat him alive because he couldn't get her off his mind. The sway of her hips led him to her door. Candles lit, vanilla scent. They filled the apartment. Have a seat, Ahmeek, she said. Her voice was sugary, full of seduction as she pulled a chair out for him, positioning it right in front of her mirrored wall. Girl, you know that you're the shit when you're walking with them heels on. Morgan tiptoed over to him and stood between his wide legs. For the entire first verse, she appreciated herself, swaying her hips, rolling her waist, and lifting her hands, then pulling her own hair before swinging it wildly. Morgan was a showwoman, the very best kind. She reached into his pocket to retrieve his phone, powering it off and tossing it to the couch. It was hers. No phone calls would be interrupting them. When that bridge hit, Morgan lowered slowly into his lap. I think it's time we take a trip to the bed. Her hands wrapped around his neck, then up the back of his head and over the top of his waves as she surfed on him, riding wood so hard that the seat of her shorts soaked. She stood and turned, her eyes closed when she felt his teeth on her ass. He peeled her shorts away and licked the entire crease of her ass. Good googly moogly. Morgan quivered as her face crushed, like the can you put in the recycle machine. She was destroyed. Lust recycled the moan that slipped from her mouth. One hand to the small of her back bent her over. Her hamstrings pulled as she placed her hands on the floor. Meek parted her, lips spreading, opening her like she was a double-sided refrigerator and he was looking for something to eat. His favorite dish, her. He dove in nose first, moving his head side to side, nestling deep, then pulling her clit into his mouth. He used so much pressure that his cheeks collapsed, dimpling as he feasted on her. Meek, she gasped as her face pinched. Mmm, he groaned, planting both hands on her ass and pulling back to admire her body as he squeezed, then rotated it. So much fucking ass in the palm of his hands, his dick ached. He wanted it so bad. My God, love, this shit. He didn't even want to take the time to undress. He reached in his joggers and gripped himself, lowering them just enough to pull her down onto him. Morgan danced, hands in front of her, snapping, eyes closed, swagging, lip trapped between her teeth, moaning, "You the shit, love." Fuck. He couldn't even control the shit that came out of his mouth. Morgan was in a zone. She had called him over with this very thing in mind. Morgan had caught a groove. She kept the beat, a little off, always a little off, as her head nodded and her hips hit circles. She switched direction, rocking on him so hard the back legs of the chair lifted every time she rolled forward. He sucked in air between his teeth as he gripped her hips. His toes curled. Morgan was working him, putting in overtime, a double shift on a holiday, so she was getting time and a half. She rolled her body left, snapped those fingers, keeping the beat. Forward, snap, right, snap, left, snap. I think it's time we take a trip to the bed. He pushed her ass up a little so he could see her sliding on, then off. He licked his lip and bit down. She glossed him so well. This pussy is amazing, love. Shit's ridiculous, he groaned. He leaned forward and planted teeth in the slight roll that gathered when she ground against him. Fuck, Mo. She popped that thing to the beat, lifting all the way to the tip of him, squatting on the dick, thighs burning, back sweating, hair swinging, heart pounding. Nobody moved like Mo. She made everything art, like she did everything to music. A lap dance, the most sensual kind, only he didn't have to pay to play. He had free access, like a 30-day trial, and He wondered if it was temporary, if he'd have to figure out how to keep coming back, switching emails every time the shit expired so he could get it again and again. Fuck it. He was signing up. Auto pay every month so he could have it whenever he liked. Some shit was just a necessity. Meeky, baby, I'm coming, she gasped. Yep, he admired as she creamed all over him. She was making a mess. Oh, shit, he exploded, and he physically picked Morgan up to avoid shooting up her club. Damn, love, I'm gonna put a baby in you. You gotta chill, he groaned. Fuck. Ahmeek was a man who could fuck all night, but Morgan had broken him down in minutes. She was that good. He'd have to make up for it on round two because there was no holding back what was coming out of him. Morgan lifted and Ahmeek grabbed her hand before she could walk away. She looked at him. This shit is fucked up, he said. I know, she answered. One hand held her lower back. The other gripped one side of her face. I know. If it has to feel a little bad to feel this good, I'll take that. I'm never letting go of this. Not ever. What time you on, Mo? Ahmeek whispered. The words didn't even feel like his own. Now he was the one asking about status. Fucking then wondering what it meant. Many women had posed the exact same question to him after an amazing night. Oh, how the tables had turned. Morgan and the ride she had given him on the Magic Morgan bus had him searching for clarity. He felt like a whole bitch. There was vulnerability hidden behind his tough exterior. Gangster ass. Hood ass. Murder Meek had been touched. Morgan had gotten to him, touched him right where his ribs be at. Anxiety caused tension in her. He felt her apprehension. Leave that nigga. I got you. I got the twins. Fuck with me, Morgan, for real. No games. No apologizing for it. Yeah, that sound like Remember that? You don't want that, she whispered. You think you do, but you don't. It's a lot, Ahmeek. It's not always like this. It's not fun. It's responsibility. We haven't even been out together yet. Me leaving with you after a night of clubbing doesn't count. So let me take you out. We had plans. You altered them, he snickered. Skating on Friday, your request. I prefer something a little more grown man, but I'm with it, love. I'm not tucking you away. I don't want to come through at night and leave in the morning. The shadows and shit. It's not how I prefer to do this. Not with you. She blushed and turned her head. You want to show me off, she whispered. He snickered, licking those lips. You pretty as fuck, Mo, but it ain't about the stunt. I just don't want you to feel like you're a secret. You hide shit that you're embarrassed about. Time's up for your nigga, though. You ain't his no more. She kissed him and Meek loved it. Bitches and their lips. It wasn't his thing. He and the crew had joked often that you couldn't trust women, that you never knew where the lips of women had been. The three roughest men in the city had all fallen victim. Morgan had taken out two of them. Aria had handled the third. He felt like a sucker as he groaned, getting lost in the taste of her, the delicacy of her. He'd heard stories of Justine Atkins, even more stories of Raven, but damn, Morgan elevated the bloodline. She would be a legend, the fucking queen that launched 1,000 ships because Ahmeek would go to war for her. I think it's time we take a trip to the bed. He carried her to the bedroom and tossed her on the bed. She laughed as she bounced and he stepped out of his clothes. He placed knuckles to the bed as he climbed on top of her. What you do to a nigga ain't normal, Morgan, he said. Morgan, huh, she said, biting his bottom lip. That's what your mama named you, nigga, he said. He was inside her, and they just lay there. That ain't what my man named me, though, she whispered. My man calls me love, so get it right next time. He smiled, and Morgan shook her head. That smile that was so rare made her heart flutter. He stroked her, and she gasped. Your man, huh, he asked. She nodded, eyes closed as she moaned. Yes, Meeky, you're mine. He was so deep and it felt so good that Morgan was elevated high. There were stars on the ceiling. He was a beast and Morgan couldn't slay him. He left her exhausted, legs quaking as they wrapped around his waist. Clit sore because when he was done, he sucked on it all night. She was spent. She could barely keep her eyes open by the time they were done. Three orgasms each before they realized any more would be gluttony. She laid on top of him, legs strewn over his body as he wrapped her with one arm. The sound of his heartbeat lulled her to sleep. This man was hers, and she was terrified of what it meant, because the last time she had given her heart to a man like Ahmeek, she hadn't come out of the situation the same. The last thing Mo wanted to do was give someone the chance to hurt her again. I gotta be careful with this. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, Linda. Poor Meeky. Morgan, you better not hurt him, bitch. Oh, my goodness. Oh, listen, let me see what y'all saying in this chat box. I just want to tell y'all, y'all are a bad influence. I was in my meeting and I said, talking about some folks, they are slow boppers for Christ. My eyes got so big. I was like, whoop, oh. Girl, don't you be stealing my shit. You better give me credit. Listen, y'all stop stealing my shit. Lord have mercy. Not you calling people slow boppers for Christ in your work meeting. No bueno, ma'am. So Kim said, damn, I ain't had no dick like that. Flip my taxes. He could pay what I owe. Child, listen. Listen, I ain't had nothing like that either. Because, listen, Linda. Mm-mm. Hey, Choco Chip. Happy hump day, darling. Thank you so much for sliding into the speakeasy and bringing a whole gaggle of good vibes with you. I appreciate you, darling. Welcome. Child, listen, I don't know if I want no dick like that. Like, for real. Now, she said, okay, because Meeky is a good man, Savannah. He is. Well, as far as we know, child, he might be a whole asshole. Ain't a whole lot of good men out here and shit. It ain't too many books written about good men either. Mm-mm. Fuck out of here. Y'all know how I give it up. No God. Probably the only good ones are the ones that are written about. But anyway, I ain't one to gossip, so you heard that bullshit from me. Mm-mm. All right, let's get into this next chapter. Chapter 2. Morgan awoke first, and the level of comfort she felt when she looked at Ahmeek made a warmth spread through her heart. She smiled, turning on her back and lifting dreamy eyes to the ceiling. She placed both hands over her face and shook her head in disbelief. She opened her fingers to peek through them just to get a glimpse of him. She had to stop the giddy titter from waking him. She had never felt like this before. She had been in love. She had been crazy in love before. Messiah had connected to her soul in ways that made them one, but with him, the emotions were so heightened that it felt risky. It gave her anxiety to be with Messiah. She had lived for that heart-pounding thrill ride. Loving Messiah was like riding a roller coaster. The thrill she had experienced with him was the same thrill she felt when she used to climb on the back of his motorcycle. Nothing made her heart race like those late-night rides. No one made her heart race like Messiah Williams. She couldn't ever take that away from him. He lit her soul on fire. Ahmeek Harris was like a big body Benz. The ride was smoother. It felt like a luxury. Ahmeek felt safe. Yes, God. For us Mercedes-Benz drivers, ain't nothing like a Benz. The ride is just, it's just unmistakable. It just, child, listen. And he a big body Benz? Good googling, moogling, child. Listen, you just kind of, the seat just kind of suck you in and cradle you like a little baby in your mama's arms if you had a good mama. Child, listen. Child, I don't miss shit. Not about movies, especially if I done seen it already. Yes, ma'am. All right. Her phone went off and Morgan reached for the nightstand, unplugging the phone from the charger to silence it before it awakened him. She wanted him to sleep. She wanted him to stay. Morgan wanted to be up under him as long as possible before the day's demands pulled him apart. Bash opened the door. He done sent her a text message. Now listen, fuck Bash. Oh, I wish she would just tell him, no, nigga, I don't fuck with you. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? I don't fuck with you. Oh, God. Her heart stalled. Morgan climbed out of bed, hurriedly throwing on her silk kimono robe and trying her hardest not to awaken Ahmeek. Her heart pounded and her legs felt like they would give out as she pulled the door to her bedroom closed. She damn near ran to the front door. She opened it slightly. "Hey, what are you doing here?" she asked. Bash frowned and put a hand to the door. Morgan pushed back. "I'm not feeling well, Bash. I know we have some things to talk about, like you running off with a nigga in the middle of your free press interview." "Yeah, we got some things to discuss, Mo. What's up with you?" he asked. "Which one of them are you fucking?" "What?" Morgan asked. "You ran off with one of Messiah's friends. Which one?" he asked. "Ahmeek, right?" Bash pushed against the door again. "What you doing? Let me in. You gonna make me talk to you through the door?" He pushed into the apartment and towered over her. "You embarrassed yourself and my family. You do the most asinine shit. We were good in London. I take you out of the ghetto and you, the ghetto? I grew up in a $1 million house. What are you talking about?" Morgan protested. "I'm talking about how you were one way in London. We come back here and you're a completely different girl, Mo. What the fuck is up? You're wearing my ring and hopping on motorcycles with bums who won't be more than the neighborhood thug." "Ooh." Did he call him a bum and a thug? Oh, wake up, Meeky, and beat his ass. Please wake up, Meeky, and beat his ass. He's not a thug. She knew she was dick whipped because she didn't even mean to defend him. Right. Okay, the accusation that the man in her bed was nothing more than a statistic pissed her off, however. "Don't defend your side, nigga, to me," Bash shouted, pointing a stern finger at her. His face burned with aggression. "He's not a side, nigga." There she went again with her defending. How could someone so important to her be a side anything? Ahmeek Harris was the main dish, the turkey on Thanksgiving. If he was a side, he was macaroni and cheese, because that's what everyone loved the most on the holiday anyway. "I can't do this right now, please. I promise. We'll talk, but just leave. My head is pounding, and I just don't want to fight." She walked to the door and held it open. "You're serious right now?" Bash asked. "I'm not going nowhere until you explain your fucking self. Are you fucking that nigga?" Uh-oh, that question. Listen. This about to be some shit. I hope Meek wake his ass up. The more upset he got, the louder the argument became. Morgan turned away from him so that he couldn't see her tear-filled eyes. She needed him to leave. She couldn't handle a confrontation. She didn't want it to get out of hand. It wasn't until this very moment that she realized how risky her affair with Ahmeek was. She should have been fearful of Bash discovering Meek, but in her twisted heart, she feared Ahmeek waking up to find Bash inside her apartment, inside their bubble. He was in front of her now. Finger in her face, hand wrapped around her neck as he pushed her hard into the door. Morgan's eyes widened in shock. He was walking a fine line as his fingers tightened around her throat. "You don't want to do this, Bash," she said. She stared him in the eyes, brow lifted. "I said we can talk later when I'm ready. You might want to loosen your grip before you do something stupid. At that point, it'll no longer be in my hands." Bash slammed a hard hand to the door. It was so close to her head that Morgan jumped. "You fucked him, didn't you? You got me out here waiting until you're ready, but you're sleeping with him?" Wasn't no sleeping, homie. Wasn't no waiting neither. And those hands around her neck like that is a bad fucking idea.
Yay, Meeky woke up. Wait.
I'm sorry, y'all. Morgan's body froze. Her stomach fell out of her. She was sure it was on the floor. The tears she had been holding in fell as she turned to face Ahmeek. He came out of the room in sweatpants, his Ralph Lauren boxers showing as they hung slightly off his waist. He was shirtless, revealing ink and abs. Abs she had traced with her tongue just hours before. His forehead wrinkled as his brow bent. Morgan was ashamed that her clit pulsed. He was so damn fine with his pretty boy looks, mean boy vibes, and his fuck boy dick print. He wasn't one, but damn if he didn't have a type of dick to ruin a bitch's life. He was in fact ruining her life, tearing up a relationship that had been perfectly fine before he had shown her how good it could feel to be loved on by a real nigga. He didn't lie, didn't conceal, didn't control. Morgan's heart ached so good that she couldn't stop the smile that played at the corners of her mouth. He leaned against the wall, chewing on the inside of his jaw, something he did when he was holding back anger. A bad habit. The taste of blood filled his mouth, and he rubbed one hand down his waves. He pulled on his beard before locking one hand around the opposite wrist. He was so calm, but Morgan knew that was a bad thing. She knew there were no civil thoughts going through Ameek's head. Bash couldn't do anything but react. He was so enraged, he pushed Morgan hard against the door, banging her head against the wood before crossing the room toward Ameek. What the fuck did you just say to... Before Bash could even finish his sentence, Ahmeek came off the wall. Morgan watched in horror. They were like two freight trains on the same track headed for one another. Ahmeek scooped Bash, sending him back first into her glass coffee table. Ahmeek didn't care that there were shards of glass everywhere. He let them cut into the bottoms of his feet as he straddled Bash, delivering vicious blows to his jaw. He clicked out. All logic went out the window. The sickening crack of bones breaking made Morgan place hands over her mouth. She hadn't wanted this. She knew she was to blame. This brutal beating was a result of her dishonesty, and Bash was undeserving. Ameek's fist crashed across Bash's face again, and Morgan recoiled. It was like she could feel the blow. Meek put a knee to Bash's neck and with one hand pressed his face hard into the glass. Ah! Bash cried out. Ameek, Morgan said. Stop! He's had enough! Meek bit down into his bottom lip because he didn't leave food on his plate. Any man he had ever put hands on, he had put dirt on, too. Morgan didn't want that, however. Meek, I said stop. I could have handled it. You should have just stayed out of it. He lifted squinted eyes to her and then looked down at Bash, who was barely conscious. Bash rolled onto his side, groaning. Ahmeek scoffed. He lifted, flexing his injured fist, open and closed, to make sure it wasn't broken. He gritted his teeth, temple throbbing. He flicked his nose in irritation and then ran his tongue across the top row of teeth before he nodded. Yo, nigga, your business, Mo, he said as he retreated to the bedroom. Morgan's lip quivered as she bent down. I'm sorry, she said, frowning. She shook her head as she helped him up to the couch. Ahmeek emerged fully dressed, keys in hand. Meek, she called after him. Morgan's lip trembled as she sprang from the couch and rushed after him. He made it all the way to the hallway before she caught him, grabbing his hand. He jerked away from her, and Morgan stopped. So you're just going to leave? I didn't say I wanted you to leave, but that wasn't necessary. You niggas and your fucking anger issues. Ahmeek advanced on her, pinning her against the wall and pointing a stern finger in her face. Ain't no you, niggas. Ain't no issues in my head or my heart, Morgan. I ain't Messiah. I ain't Issa. I don't fucking pop off unless it's necessary. Niggas don't run up on me and live to tell about it. The nigga had his hand wrapped around your throat, but I'm the bad guy? Fuck out of here. Just calm down, please, she whispered. Meek raised both hands in surrender and backpedaled. I'm calm. I'm out of it, Mo, he said. He took the air in her lungs with him as he left. Morgan walked back into her apartment and Bash burned a hole in her with his stare. He sat on the couch, leaned onto his elbows, head drooping as he licked blood from his lip. Morgan went to the kitchen, retrieving a wet towel before returning to Bash. She tried to place it to his bloody face, but Bash snatched it from her hands, opting to do it himself. Morgan's soul left her body as she exhaled. I really didn't want you to find out this way. I've been unhappy for a long time, Bash, she said, her voice low. Since when? We were good, Morgan. We were building together. You were building, Bash. I was just following orders. Your mother, she planned out my entire life. She has me lying about who my kids belong to, has me dressing to her standards, speaking, walking, eating to her standards, Bash. All for what? To uphold your family's name. I can't breathe when I'm with you, and it's not even your fault. How long you been fucking him? Morgan was silent as she sat beside him. Her eyes were on the glass pieces on the floor. Those pieces reminded her of herself, of her heart. She was shattered, and although she seemed okay, no amount of glue would be able to piece her together again. Ahmeek was trying, and Morgan wished she could let him. But no one knew how hard it was to trust again. The things she felt for Ahmeek were terrifying. They made her vulnerable. It made her ache inside, and she couldn't depend on that feeling to stay. She didn't want to get used to it because her past had taught her that it wouldn't last. Ahmeek would feel good until one day he didn't, and Morgan couldn't put all her eggs in his basket. That basket would grow weak, and when it broke, she didn't want her soul cracked, like last time. So she kept Bash around. Bash didn't make her weak. He wasn't capable of it. He provided friendship without requiring her vulnerability. She loved him on the surface, but she hadn't explored his depths. She had no desire to. She was satisfied with a shallow connection. A shallow hole could be filled. If she let another man dig deep and then he left, she would never be the same. Bash was safe. Her silence was all the answer he needed, and she knew it hurt him, but she couldn't defend wrong. She was wrong. The way she had carried him was wrong, but she would rather give hurt than receive it. She had been taught that somebody in a relationship always felt pain, and she had vowed to never be the one to feel that way again. I know that's right. He scoffed. I'm wasting my time with you. I've raised your kids as my own and put the whole world at your feet, and you out here hoeing for that nigga. He had never raised his voice at her before. His tone shocked her. I'm not screaming. I'm not fighting. I just want to walk about where we go from here. Oh, sorry. Talk about where we go from here. Sorry. Morgan stated. You're a fucking piece of work, he stated. You're worthless. You weren't shit when I met you. A little girl with a drug dealing daddy from the ghetto. I should have left your ass there. Morgan's eyes widened. Wow, she scoffed. She went to stand and Bash pulled her arm, jerking her so hard her knees hit the ground, sinking into the glass. Don't walk away when I'm talking to you. You're my fiance. Well, maybe I shouldn't be, Morgan screamed as she pushed him off her. He stood towering over her. Yes, I'm fucking him. He knows me. He knows Morgan Atkins, the daughter of a drug dealer from Flint. And instead of judging me for it, he loves that shit. He fucking cherishes me for who I am right now today, not who he can turn me into. Morgan pulled the ring off her finger. I'm not your fiance. You're not engaged to Morgan Atkins. I don't even know the girl who said yes to you. Bash pulled the corner of his bloody lip into his mouth and touched it with his thumb, frowning as he shook his head. You don't want to be with me, Mo? You gonna take those kids from me after everything I've done for you? It just doesn't feel like this is where I'm supposed to be. But you're supposed to be with him. They're all the same, Mo. He's not sticking around. He gonna leave you just like the nigga before. Wasn't that man Messiah's friend? You would rather crawl around in the gutter as a pass around than marry somebody who can elevate you. The words jolted her. Have some respect, Mo, Bash stated. I asked you to be my wife. What have any of them ever done besides fuck you? Morgan had never felt so low. She placed the back of one hand to her forehead and one hand on her stomach as she tried to stop his words from ripping through her. She was choking on cries, refusing to let them spill. He had hurt her feelings so badly. He had pointed out the obvious, and the thought that she was nothing more than a conquest to Ahmeek brought her to tears. Bash sat on the couch, leaning over onto his knees and shaking his head as he stared at the floor. Tell me what he is giving you that I don't, he whispered, calming, forcing his anger down to give way to what he was really feeling, loss. I don't know, Morgan whispered as a tear fell down her cheek. He just understands me. Help me understand you, Mo. Do you not love me because I love the hell out of you, he admitted, from the first time I saw you. Morgan broke. Even after discovering her in bed with another man, even with the smell of Ahmeek still on her skin, even after taking a brutal beating, Bash still wanted her, was still professing his love. It reminded her of Messiah. It reminded her of how Messiah had taken advantage of her love for him. She was doing that in this moment, hurting Bash, taking advantage of him because she knew he loved her more. Messiah had turned her heartless. Messiah had turned her into a fucked up person, someone who went around selfishly stealing hearts just to break them simply because she could. I do care about you, Bash. It's just not, she paused. How could she word this? How could she say how she felt without hurting him more? You're my friend. I care about you like that. Like I look at you and I see my best friend. We joke. We have a good time. The twins adore you. You're kind, but I'm not in love with you. I can't be because there is shit in my heart that stops me from falling too hard. After Messiah, I can't fall that hard. I need to remain in control of my heart, of my life, and your family takes control of me. I have no freedom. Your mom is a bitch, Mo. Everyone knows she's a bitch. I don't want her to be the reason I lose you. Okay, you don't love me. You can grow to love me, though, Morgan. Love grows. It's not dangerous. I'm not dangerous. I'm not a gangster. I'm not from the streets, but I'll love you right, Mo. I don't know if that's enough, she answered. I don't know if I can be who you want. Don't throw the past 2 years away for him. Dash answered. Just give me a chance to keep my hat in the ring. Wear my ring, Mo. I know I fucked up in Vegas. I was angry and I was dead ass wrong, Morgan. If this is payback for that, let it be done. I fucked up. You fucked up. Now, let's get it right. You left my kids backstage by themselves, Morgan said, shaking her head. Don't do that, Mo. They're mine too. You know I'm here for them like they belong to me. But they don't. It's clear that you don't really feel that way because you would never have left them if they were yours, if they shared your blood and had your last name. And he loves them better? You think he'll love you better? I don't know, Morgan shouted. He's just, she sighed as anxiety built in her chest. I don't know. Just give me a chance to make it right. Dash pulled her into his arms. The feeling of his hands around her waist didn't repulse her, but the embrace didn't warm her like it should. There was no safety in his touch, no power, no aggression, just desperation. He was desperate not to lose her. Morgan was full of regrets. She should have never allowed him to sneak out of the friend zone. He had helped her through some of the hardest days of her life, and she felt obligated to give him something in return. She was repaying a debt to him by giving him partnership, promising him marriage. She had never even said yes, not to the proposal, not to the relationship, not to any of it. She had gone along with things because nothing was worth caring about. She had been caught in the grips of depression and grief while Bash made plans for the rest of her life. He had taken her silence as permission. Bash had coerced a space in her life when she was in the worst of states, and now she felt trapped. Morgan never expected to find someone who made her want to love again. She had been okay with settling before. Now she wanted greatness. Now she wanted someone else, and guilt was eating her alive because Bash had done his part. He had been a support to her, and it still wasn't enough. She wondered if it were true, if she could learn to love him, if she could be happy one day with Bash the way she was when she was with Ahmeek. She still couldn't believe that she felt that way about a man she should have no feelings for at all, but was so potent, and it made her not want to accept anything that came with delusion. Okay, she said, giving in. Motherfucker, I'm sorry. He deserved the chance. That was the least she could do. But this is a lot. It's too much fighting and yelling. I need some space to think. Just a day or two, please. Whatever you need, Mo. Do I need to worry about you with him? He asked. Morgan looked him in the eyes and shook her head. No, it's done. I'll end it. And that's the end of that chapter. That's it. I'm through with this fucking book. Goodbye, y'all. I'm about to go eat some bacon or something. I need some comfort food right now. I am fucking annoyed. Morgan is, I keep telling y'all, this bitch is a slow bopper for Christ, man. I cannot. Sorry, my ancestors were in the building, Chalice. It's 4:44. I just like it. Listen, I cannot. That was the end of that chapter. Did I say that? Because I just, let me just scroll back up and see what the fuck y'all say. Oh my God. Why, y'all? Why does she do stupid shit? This girl is just, and you know what the sad part about it is? It's chicks out here with this same scenario that are going through this exact same thing right now. And they are like, oh, on the fence. This is just fucking dumb. I don't even know what to say. Just let me sip some coffee because I'm the fuck annoyed. Oh my God. All right, so Naquetta said, my 17-year-old keeps looking at me crazy. Every time she walks in, you're reading a sex scene in whatever book. Child, listen, all of these books have sex scenes. Tell your baby to go in her room and do her homework or something. Yeah, no. Mm-mm. Oh, my goodness. You said Bash showed her what he's capable of. Right. Because, you know, listen, even a fucking dude that's like, you know, like incredibly passive, when driven to anger, when they feel used, when they feel mistreated or disrespected, even Steve Urkel could punch a bitch in the face. Right. Y'all be thinking y'all got these simp ass niggas out here that won't put hands on you. Yeah, you push the right fucking button. Might take you 10 years to find it, but you push the right fucking button and he will drive your fucking head through one of them walls. Right. You'll be looking like a fine piece of fucking art on the wall. Right. You'll be looking like a life-size fucking statue. And then, you know, you'll be on Black Girl Unlost or some shit because thinking that you in control of some shit. No. So just don't be out here fucking around. She should have told that dude, hey, man, you fucking suck. You're boring. I don't like it. You know? And I just feel like, No. What DMX say? You broke, the kid ain't yours, and everybody know. So he ain't broke, but you know, the kids ain't his and everybody know it. You know, you thinking you keeping that shit silent. You wanted to seclude her away from her family. Beware of the dude that wants to put you in a beautiful surroundings far away from your family. That's the type of shit that sneak up on your ass. Right? They do that. Right? These regular dudes, right? Not the gangster, not the thug, you know, the regular dude, the nice guy, seclude you away from your fucking family. They isolate you. Mm-hmm. And then when you try to break free, well, there you have it. You're getting your face fucking dug in and, you know, you're trying to figure out why the fuck your nose is poking out the back of your fucking head. You're rationalizing when he turned into this guy, but he always was. So stop fucking over people. Don't do that, right? Don't promise somebody something that you're not really willing to deliver because, yeah, he could have fucked Morgan up. You see, he was about to choke a booger out her ass. I forgot y'all don't know me and the shit I be saying. But anyway, listen, he was about to do that. So Nequetta says she definitely don't need to be with Batch. Right. He's showing his true colors. Right. He absolutely is. Child, listen. With the rind on, you heard me? Morgan do know better. Shit. She know to not fuck around with somebody's fucking emotions. Right? Because she remembers how she felt when Messiah told her, yeah, no, I ain't with it. Get the fuck out of here. She should have told Batch. Now, she just sat there and rationalized the whole you did. And instead of her saying, you know what, Batch? I don't give a fuck. Fuck you. Fuck your whack-ass mama. And fuck your passive-ass daddy. Okay? I'm out. Please leave. But that's what Bash wanted. He knew. See, desperate man, this ain't the first time this nigga done this type of shit, right? He knew that if he fucking sat there, he could convince her because the angry dude always leaves. Think about that. The dude that's the angriest always leaves. And then what happens? The sucker-ass motherfucker, the desperate motherfucker, the nigga that will kill you. Because this is the one that'll kill you. This one is the one that will kill you. He will watch you die. Mm-hmm. He'll watch you die. He stays back, right? Let you tend to his cuts and shit. He's so mad. He's so angry. They'll call her a slut, a hoe, a bitch, a trick, and she sucked dick, giving up the lips in between her hips. Right? All of that. He said all of that. But he still want to be with her. Bruh, if she all of that, if she's the daughter of a drug dealer from the ghetto, why the fuck you still want to be with her, sir? Because you're a weirdo. You're a weirdo. And Morgan, your cornbread is not done, bitch, because you talking about, okay, I'll give you a chance. But you know your heart ain't in it. Open your fucking eyes. Oh, God. I just don't get it. I don't understand. He should have been the one to leave. Yo, woman, sir. You reminded us she had your ring on. This bitch just let a nigga, a thug, with big meat, heavy meat, beat your ass. That nigga sat on your chest and worked you over like Big Dog Rover. He worked you over. You're a bitch, sir, because you should have left. You should have been scrambling to get up out of there like a bear on all fours. But you didn't. You stayed there begging this. You should stop and think about it, sir.
You elevated her life, right? And for 2 years, you did that shit, and she didn't fuck you. She fucked the big dick dangler because he was folding that shit up in her. He was pounding it from the back like blunt force trauma, and she was taking that shit like a champ. And you the one with the glass jaw laying on the fucking ground getting bitched. And you still want to be with her, sir? She has his semen. Oh, wait. He didn't bust because, well, he did, but not in her. He didn't shoot up the club. Because I was about to say, his motherfucking soldiers is leaking out the club right now. You talking to her, and it should smell like his dick. I'm so fucking crass. Her breath smells like his dick, sir. If you kiss her, you might as well call him back and say, fuck it, I'll suck it. Right. Because it's been all down her throat. And you're dumb. You're staying with this. This is some bullshit, yo. And Morgan, you ain't shit because you need to let his busted ass go. That nigga's the one that'll kill your ass. Ethic gonna have to put a bullet in this nigga. But don't worry about it. I got a feeling once Messiah step back on the scene, him and Meek gonna fight. But I think before that, Messiah gonna fuck Bash up. I don't know. But I'm hoping he do. Somebody need to beat his ass. Meek done beat his ass, but he's still coming, right? That show you the nigga Cornbread ain't done. Why the fuck would you stay with somebody that fucking... She fucked that nigga, man. She had him hit from the back, son. And you done had desert dick and dry balls for 2 years, and you done gave up I don't know how much. And you begging her. Nigga, you's a bitch. I said it. Argue with your fucking stuffy ass mama. All right, the whole hood said you stupid. You be like, so right. I love my baby mama. I never let her go. Right. Yes, choke a booger. Choke a booger out of her. When you choke somebody and so hard that they be gasping for air and a booger shoot out their nose, I mean, it really happens. It might land on your hand or whatever, or maybe on your shirt, but yeah, that's what happened. Like, it happens. Like, I'm being serious right now. If you ain't never choked nobody that hard, you ain't done shit. All right. Okay. So Morgan, man, can easily... No, Morgan is a dummy. Her mind can't be manipulated. She just dumb. This bitch is... She's smart and dumb at the same time. She's smum. Smart and dumb. Smum. Smum-ass bitch. Oh, my God. Okay. So, yes, his meat is very heavy, child. Listen. Right. Quit walking in without knocking. You never know what she might catch you doing. I mean, I'm just saying, like, yes, knock. You just lock your door, girl. Lock your door so she can't come in your room. All right. Let me get my time stamp together, child, so that we could get into this next chapter. Because, listen, y'all ain't going to worry me with this shit. I know you lying. Mm-mm. Y'all about to get about 30 more minutes out of me. And then I'm going to dip out on y'all ass for the day. And then we'll see about some shit tomorrow. I know, right? And I bet you if Ethic knew that he had his fucking hands around her neck, he think Meek beat his ass. Listen, Ethic ain't going to even lay hands on him. He going to part that nigga motherfucking scalp with some hot metal. And I don't blame him. Mm-mm. This is insane, y'all. I'm annoyed. Because, like, poor Meeky, and his mama was right. That girl was going to hurt him. And now look at him. Sitting up here just, Morgan, you a dummy. Oh, I don't even know what to say. I don't. I don't know, y'all. I feel some type of way. Oh, my God. And for those of you that have already read the book, like, just... Let me be mad. Like, I have to cycle through my emotions with these whack-ass fucking people. So, just don't even say nothing. All right, let's get into this next one. Chapter 3. So it's nothing fancy. Four walls, one bedroom, one bath. Rent is $800 a month. I'll need first and last, plus deposit. Messiah looked around the small space and pulled in a deep breath. This was a far cry from what he had once possessed. He had fallen so far from the throne, he didn't even remember what it felt like to be on top. He'd given every dime he had to Morgan. He didn't regret it. She deserved it. He hoped it had done some good, a consolation for breaking her heart. He was down, but Messiah had no worries. He could get to the money in his sleep. He wouldn't be down long. I'll take it, he said. He peeled off $2,500 from the small knot he had in his pocket. It was half of what he had to his name. Damn, nigga came back to town with $5,000. That's it? Thinking he gonna get Morgan back? Fuck out of here, broke ass nigga. I don't know what he was thinking. Anyway, it was half of what he had to his name. He had clothes, his car, his bike, a handful of guns, and $2,500 left. A legit man would sell the toys for cash, but Messiah was an outlaw. The all-white BMW represented a status he once held in the streets, a king, the king. He would rather grind up than get rid of him. The woman placed a key on the countertop and pulled a lease agreement from the folder she clutched to her chest. I'll just need your signature on a few pages and you'll be all set, she said. Messiah took the pen and signed his name. The leasing agent walked out and Messiah hopped up onto the countertop, looking around the empty space. It reminded him of Moe's place, of the day he had moved her into her apartment all those years ago. He was so close to her, in the same zip code, but he couldn't reach out. Not yet. Ethic had been clear. Messiah needed to wait until the right time to approach Morgan because she had been through a lot. He wondered what a lot meant. How had she coped after he had disappeared? It tore him apart thinking of the way she had hurt after he left. He knew she would have a hard time, but he had been in a situation where life and death trumped emotions. Leaving her felt less cruel than making her watch him die. If he could go back, he would do things a bit different because when things became unbearable, he would have given anything to hear her voice. He had made a mistake by abandoning her. He just wanted to make it right. He would be unsettled until he saw her face. Seeing Ethic, gaining his forgiveness so easily gave him hope that Mo would accept him back into her life. She would be mad, but he would take that. He would take whatever energy she was giving as long as she let him come home. Messiah grabbed the key and flipped up the hood of his sweatshirt before walking out. He couldn't sit around waiting. If he was going to come back for Mo, he wasn't coming empty-handed. He had to have more to offer than just himself because he knew he wasn't worth shit in her book. He couldn't let anyone else know he was back before telling Mo. Even Issa and Ahmeek had to wait. He would just have to keep a low profile until Ethic gave him the green light. Until then, he would put in work to get back on his feet. And that's the end of that chapter. Man, fuck you, nigga. Go back to wherever the fuck you was at and just go away. Go away. When that doctor offered him the surgery and he turned it down, I was mad. I was like, all right, fuck it, he did. And now we want her, listen, now I done went from I to we. We in the speakeasy want her to be with Meeky. And now here come this fucking nigga. Is he still bald headed? I'm annoyed. He need to go away. Damn, man. Niggas always fucking. Okay, thank you. I need him gone. All right. Chapter 4. The money machine was the soundtrack for the evening as Meek and Issa sat around the living room table counting up. Issa balanced a short blunt between his lips as his hands flipped through the bills in front of him. A knock at the door lifted Issa from his seat as he reached for the chrome pistol that laid on the table covered money. Oh, sorry, the table covered money. The money covered table. The fuck, dyslexic ass. That's beans? Ahmeek inquired as his chocolate fingers ran through the money in his hand, dropping off the bag. His block's going crazy, Issa stated. He peeked out the blinds before reaching the door and then pulled it open. A handshake amongst gangsters was the formal greeting before the mountain of a man lowered his head to step inside the house. Murder Meek, the man greeted. Meek stood briefly, dapping him up with one hand before reclaiming his seat. Beans, baby, what's good? Meek acknowledged. Shit. Everything, Beans said, dropping the duffel at Meek's feet. You gotta bust this down? Meek asked, unzipping the bag to reveal that it was stuffed to the tip top with banded rolls of money. Nah, that's all you. That's your cut. Not a dollar short, he said. Square business, Meek answered. Ahmeek resumed counting, glancing up the 65-inch screen on the wall. The Lakers game played in front of him, but his hands flipped through the bread while he watched, never losing count. He was accurate at all things money, all things logic. Ahmeek was all G. He could bang with the best of them, but he was well aware that his biggest weapon was his mind. Bron letting off tonight, Ahmeek noted. I had the shit playing on XM on the way over. He going for the triple-double, ain't he? Beans asked as he pulled up his pants and took a seat on the couch. Mm-hmm. Homie bringing that bag home for a nigga. I got 5 bands on the first half. Lakers minus 2, Issa said. You covering that? Ahmeek stated, surely. Issa held out the blunt. Meek grabbed it, placing it between his lips, pulling hard before passing it back. He held it in for an extra beat before blowing it out. What's good, bro? You grim than a motherfucker, Beans noted. Nigga spell grim, Ahmeek shot back as he put the weed in rotation, passing it to Beans. Beans laughed and took the blunt. More money got this nigga in his bag. More crazy than a motherfucker, man, Issa said, snickering. I don't never want no bitch like that. One thing go wrong and a nigga whole world fucked up. Nah, I'm good, G. Fuck you talking about? We talking about feelings now, nigga? Meek chastised, face bent in frustration. Count this money, bruh. I ain't speaking on Mo. I'm just saying, nigga, that pussy got a bang because Mo out here casting spells like this shit is bewitched, Issa said, laughing. Meek shook his head, leaning forward on his elbows, but offered no response. Shorty got ass for days. I'd be chin deep in that shit, my nigga. I heard that shit sliding down a nigga throat like rosé. Call that bitch Mo Wet. Not Mo Wet. M-O dash Wet. W-E-T. I don't know why shit like that tickles me, but whatever. Ahmeek's entire body went still, and he sucked his front teeth, running his tongue along the inside of his jawline as his forehead dipped. Yo, bruh, go get that bottle out the fridge. Let's pop one, Ahmeek stated calmly. It was the type of tranquility that made everything go silent when a storm was approaching. Hell yeah, I'm with it. I ain't got nowhere to be, Bean stated, eyes on the game. Issa shook his head. Here we go, Issa muttered as he went to retrieve the bottle. Ahmeek finessed his beard and then rubbed his hands together until Issa returned with the bottle. You say that pussy slide down a nigga throat like Moet? Ahmeek asked, looking at Beans deadpanning on him with so much conviction that his malice wasn't to be missed. Beans froze. Nigga, you for real right now? You capping over pussy, my nigga? As much pussy as we done tossed up. You hit him and pass him down, homie. Pass that shit the fuck down when you done, Beans chuckled. Issa groaned. Say less, my nigga, damn. Meek popped the top on the champagne, sending the cork flying. He tipped it to his mouth, out of nowhere. He brought the bottle crashing into the side of Bean's face. He hit him so hard that the bottle broke, sending glass deep into Meek's hand. Meek didn't let up. He gripped Bean's collar as he delivered audible blows to Bean's bloody face. Call that bitch what? Mo Wet, nigga? You want to know what it tastes like sliding down your throat? Meek grew on him, placing his gun right beneath Bean's chin. Yo, Meek, man, I ain't mean no disrespect. Issa, man, Bean screamed. Issa sat disinterested with his eyes following the game. Nah, G, that's all you. You got it. That Moet crack about to get your ass wet the fuck up. Better start praying. I just want to know what you said, G, because I know I had to hear that shit wrong. What you say you call her? Moet? Nah, man, no. I ain't know you was fucking with it like that. Issa was joking. I was just playing, man. I'm sorry. What you call her, nigga? Meek sneered. Nothing, the man cried. Meek pushed him off with so much aggression that Beans fell across the table, fucking up the count. That's right, bitch ass nigga. You don't call her nothing. Matter of fact, when you see her, you better lower your fucking eyes, pussy. Goofy ass nigga. I'll fuck your bitch then put one between her fucking eyes for that silly ass shit you just said, nigga. Ahmeek was straddling Beans, barking at him, gripping his collar. Yo, bruh, let the nigga breathe, man, Issa said, chuckling, because I ain't recounting this shit. Make his ass do it. Meek pushed Beans to the floor and backpedaled. He was foaming at the mouth. He was so pissed. Clean this nigga up, man, bleeding all over my motherfucking money, Meek uttered as he stormed out the room. He retreated to the kitchen, snatching open the refrigerator, pulling out water because Morgan had him thirsty. The ways he needed to be quenched in her moisture.
drenched in her wet was ridiculous. As Meek tilted the bottle to his lips, his heart dipped. Yes, he was thirsty as fuck. He wrapped his bloody hand in a towel and then ran both hands down his head. Morgan had him on ice. No communication. It had been a week since he'd seen her. He was going crazy. Being away from her had him out of character. He was acting without thought, punishing niggas because she was punishing him. It shouldn't feel this impossible to move around a woman. He had done it before, to dozens. He wasn't shit if he had made them feel this. Morgan had his mind so fucked up that all he wanted to do was mob. He hadn't slept in days. Life had turned into 24-hour cycles of getting money or getting high. He was blown. He wouldn't press her, however. It was like she was his karma for all the hearts he had broken, all the women he had used as playthings over the years. Morgan was playing with him like he was a toy for her enjoyment. Meek couldn't get her off his mind. Oh, listen, not heavy Meek. You stupid, Norris. Morgan lay in bed, eyes to the ceiling, tears sliding into her ears as her mind tortured her. Masari's feet were directly next to her face. His wild tossing and turning had turned him upside down in her bed. She turned her head, letting a tear fall with gravity as she planted a kiss to his perfect little toes. Mommy, Yara signed. Morgan turned her head the other way, staring into the bright eyes of her baby girl. Where's Papa? She signed. Morgan's lip quivered and she tapped it quickly, forcing a smile. Your daddy's dead, baby. He left me and he never came back. The thought tore up everything in its path. Utter destruction. Morgan couldn't contain the sadness. He's back at home in London, baby. You know the big house? Morgan signed. Yara nodded. He's there. Morgan was relieved that Bash had been called away for work. He wouldn't be back until graduation. It gave her time to think, but Morgan's heart and her mind were screaming two different things. They were at war, and she couldn't decide which one to trust. She wasn't sure about anything at this point. The seeds of doubt that Bash had put into her head were growing. Doubt about Ameek's intentions made her ignore every attempt he made to reach out. Where's Meeky, Mommy? Yara sighed. Morgan had to turn her head away as her lips pulled tight in angst and her chest quaked. Morgan rolled up and laid Yara down. Lie down, Yollipop. It's time for bed, she sighed. Good night, Mama. No, good night. Mama loves you. I'm sorry. She turned on the nightlight and fled the room. She gripped her phone so tightly that it felt like it would break. She pressed the home button and her fingerprint unlocked the screen. She was in her pictures before she could stop herself. When she saw his face, she crumbled, sliding down the wall until her butt touched the floor. She tucked her legs beneath her Indian style and gazed at the four of them. It had been the most perfect day. The zoo, the smile on all of their faces told a story of love wrapped in exhaustion because they had walked around the exhibits all day. She couldn't even describe the way she missed him. Morgan gripped her phone in both hands, bringing them to her forehead and putting elbows to knees. She just wanted to shut off her feelings, to make everything go dark. She had felt that way before, in that garage, years ago. She had just wanted it all to go away. Morgan didn't understand why this felt like that. The only difference was Morgan couldn't even fathom hurting herself. Meek had acknowledged the bitch in her. The fighter, he had said. So even though she was dying without him, she couldn't do anything but feel the shit. He had called her strong, and although many people had told her that before, he was the first person she had ever believed. Morgan sent the picture in a text with the caption, "A perfect day." Her heart pulled inside her chest as she awaited his response. And then he responded, "Are you okay?" And she responded, "Yes." And he asked her, "Can I come?" And she paused. Her fingers lingered, hovering over the screen. Oh, how she wanted to say yes. She wanted him to fly up the highway and be at her door within the hour because she knew he would. But she couldn't. What she had begun with him had been a mistake. They couldn't possibly have a future together. Their past alone made it impossible. Morgan couldn't ruin her entire family. She couldn't count on him to be more than a fling. Bash had been consistent for 2 years. He had stood by her through the birth of babies that didn't belong to him. Pause. That just made him a dumbass. He claimed them, supported them. Pause. That just made him a stupid ass. The only time he had slipped is when her loyalty began to. Granted, he hadn't known at the time that she was falling for someone else, but perhaps, subconsciously, Morgan had treated him differently, so he had begun to feel disconnected from her twins.
If I let things go back to normal, everything will be fine. He would have never left him backstage if I hadn't started this with Ahmeek. Maybe he felt me pulling away, so he pulled away from them too. I have to let this go. Meek will never stick around. He will never commit to a life with a woman with two kids that aren't his. Bash is here and willing to stay. He's who they know as their dad. Pause, bitch. You're dumb, because it ain't got shit to do with you pulling away. If a motherfucker really fuck with your kids, he would never, ever leave them. And if he really fuck with you, he would never hurt you by pulling away from your kids. And even if you end it, if he'll still be their dad. Like, what the fuck are you talking about? If his feelings for your children are swayed by your behavior, then his feelings for your children are predicated upon you making him feel secure with you. And that is not genuine. And your children deserve better than that. And Meek treated your kids like they were his own, and he don't even know that they belong to his best friend, his quote-unquote brother. He thought their daddy was that simp-ass fucking stick-up-his-asshole-ass Bash, and he still treated them well because they're a part of you. Loving you means loving your children. Bash don't give a fuck about you, bitch. You're a trophy to sit on his fucking mantle. That's it. All the girls over there in London probably look like his mammy. And that's why he don't want them. He wants you. He wants you because you're the trophy. But he don't give a fuck about you. He gives a fuck about how you make him look. That's why he mistreated your kids when he couldn't get his fucking way. He don't give a fuck about them kids, you dumbass bitch. Man. If a nigga fuck with you, he could never fuck over your kid. Do y'all know that there are men out there right now today that used to fuck with a bitch that had kids, right? And when they busted up and they were the only father that those kids know, do you know those men still do for those children? And they done moved on and got a whole nother bitch and done married her. And they're still doing for children that don't belong to them. That's a man. This nigga Bash left them kids backstage because you broke one of his rules. That's the reason why. He's a bitch. He don't give a fuck about you or your kids, you fucking dummy. Anyway, with tears running down her face, she replied, "No." And then he responded, "Whenever you're not okay, you know to hit my line, right?" And she responded, "I know." Morgan picked herself up from the floor and wiped her eyes. She blew out a weighted breath. Just the words in her phone, just the reassurance of his text, chased the thoughts of giving up out of her head. And then she texted him again, "Thank you." And he responded, "Every time, love." He knew exactly what she was thanking him for, and Morgan smiled. She hoped he would text more. He didn't. "Yeah, 'cause fuck you." Morgan clicked out of the screen. She wondered if Meek was that good of an actor or if he could really be different for her. It was so hard to trust that he wouldn't hurt her. And because of that, she let the silence linger. She let it fester. And it was the loudest thing she had ever heard. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Instead of her saying to him, "Hey, yo, nigga, I got concerns that if I leave Bash, you know, the bird in the hand, for the one in the bush, or the one in my heart, you, there's some concern that you might leave, that you're not in this for the long haul. The nigga whose ass you beat told me that, yeah, you ain't fucking with me like that. Like, is he on to something?" These are adult conversations. Now, there is nothing stopping him from being a lying ass motherfucker and saying, "Hell yeah, I'm in it to win it. I'm in this for life." And then 3 years later, dumping your ass, you know, and flushing after he wipes his ass. But listen, ain't nothing to stop Bash from doing the same thing. If he meet a bitch across the pond with wooden ass teeth, because that's what they teeth look like to me, and deciding that she's a proper fit for his life, and he dump your ass and your motherfucking kids, leave you with nothing, and ship you back across the fucking pond. Ruin your fucking career. You know, the one his mammy done mapped out for you. There's no guarantees in shit, ma'am. You could wake up tomorrow and decide you don't want to fuck with none of these motherfuckers and run off and get you a whole bitch, like a woman. Like, you could just wake up and decide to follow that calling. We're humans. We do all types of shit. We know we think we want bacon, but once the bacon start cooking, we be like, I don't really want that shit. I really want some chicken. I mean, I'm going to eat the fuck out the bacon, but I don't really want some chicken. I'm just saying, we're fickle because we're humans. We want what we want, and then until we see something else. Like, literally, think about that. You don't want shit new until somebody put it on a commercial, right? If all your shit is working proper in your home, right? Ain't nothing wrong with it. But that new fucking refrigerator come out, where you could tap on the screen and look at it, you go, damn, I want that. You didn't want it before you saw it on the fucking commercial. The refrigerator you got was working just fine. But you upgraded because they showed it to you. Now you can't live without it. Same thing with these people with these fucking IEP phones. You go from the IEP phone to the IEP pad to the IEP MacBook Pro Air, whatever the fuck it is. That shit, right? You gotta have all that shit. You don't really need all that shit, but y'all do it anyway. You don't know what you want until you see something that triggers it. That's it. So, he could be the real deal, or he could be the world's best liar. But for Bash to be able to get in your fucking dome, girl, you already got low self-esteem, but you really acting like a fucking slow bopper for Christ. And I am the fuck annoyed. All right, y'all, here we go with this last chapter, because oh, this is what happens when you go all day, child. All right, here we go. Let me see. Let me get my time set. I just been putting it off and putting it off. And I was like, go eat, go eat, go eat. Yeah, no. Mm-mm. I put it off. I did. Sorry. I'm not really sorry. But sorry, I got to leave y'all. Chapter 5. Aria stood in the long line of students. Her face was knitted in irritation. There were so many graduates picking up their caps and gowns that the task would take forever. She was grateful for the musical distraction in her headphones. She was already putting the 8 count together in her head. Her head was bowed, eyes focused on her phone as she typed in a count so she would remember the moves for later. Aria didn't have time to waste. There was an audition for background dancers on a big summer tour, and she had to be there. There was no doubt she'd get the gig. There was never one that she tried out for that she didn't land. She secured her bag effortlessly. Spending hours in the studio dancing her life away, she made sure she was the very best, the creme de la creme. College was just a way to get more technical experience under her belt. She had breezed through the School of Dance at Michigan State, perfecting the art of her body, learning more about the rigidity and fluidity of movement. It helped her to compete, to be both self-taught and professionally trained. Aria was a beast. Her phone rang and Issa's name popped up on her screen. She smiled, hating the way that just 3 letters next to each other, ISA, made her insides liquefy. She had waited all day to hear from him. Every time he spoke the name he had given her, Aria's heart skipped beats, but she played Issa real casually. It didn't matter that they were engaged. He was the type of man you had to keep on his toes. There would be no growing bored on her watch. No matter how pressed she was, she'd never show him. He would never know it, but she was head over heels for him. And then he sends her a text. Nigga, answer your motherfucking phone. Nope, Aria said to herself. His name flashed on her phone again, and she buttoned him again. She decided when he had access to her, and despite what he seemed to believe, it wasn't 24/7. She had a life outside of him, and he would have to learn how to respect that. She was still in the training stage with Issa. You must want me to bust your ass, Ali, Issa said. Aria never saw him coming. Ah, boy, she shouted. Taken by surprise as he scooped her, making her drop her phone as he pressed her back to the wall and lifting her dress so far up that her thong showed. Issa! Aria tried to climb out of his arms, but he hoisted her higher, tossing her little ass so high that she straddled his face. Aria had never been so embarrassed. Issa, no! Issa, stop! She fussed as he slid her panties to the side and ran his tongue along her lips. gave her clit a sloppy kiss. The other students in line gawked at them. "Baby, you got me out here looking crazy," she groaned as he kissed her inner thigh. "Put me down." Aria couldn't help but twirl on his tongue for the one time as she pleaded to be released. "When I fucking call your phone, you pick up for me every time. You put whatever lame-ass nigga that's in your face shooting his shot on hold, and you pick the fuck up," he said. He bit her thigh. "Ow, Issa!" Aria swung, knocking him upside his head so hard he dropped her. "I'ma fuck your little ass up," he said. He grabbed her up, tossing her over his shoulder and planting a smack to her ass so hard that her skin burned. She hollered in laughter as he spun her in a circle and walked away from the line. "Wait, Issa, I've been in this line for 40 minutes. My phone," she protested. He paused and turned to the group of students, then walked to the beginning, still carrying her over his shoulder. "Fuck your phone. You probably got whole niggas calling that bitch anyway," he said, as he sank his teeth into the skin of her thigh, biting just enough to pull a yelp out of her. "Excuse me, sir, there's a line," the advisor who sat behind a desk at the front of the line said. Issa went into his pocket and pulled out a knot of $100 bills. He didn't even care to count it. He tossed the entire thing on the desk. "Aria Taylor," he said, "I need that cap and gown up out you." Oh my God, now I need that cap and gown up out you. The advisor eyed the money and went to retrieve it. "Now you gonna ride with me for a minute?" he asked. "I have an audition at 3. "I'll get you there," he said. He placed her on her feet when they were at his car, all white BMW, the car he barely drove because he was an adrenaline junkie and his bike suited him better. He removed his keys from his pocket and tossed them in the air. Aria caught them. "I'm driving? I can't play in that pussy and drive at the same time, Ali." "Nigga, this ain't driving, Miss Daisy. Hop your pretty ass behind the wheel," Issa said. Aria stopped walking, frowning. "Who you think you talking to?" she asked. I can just go about my day. You interrupted what I had going on." Issa blew out a breath of frustration. "Ali, I don't want no smoke. Can you just not give a nigga a hard time and drive?" She rolled her eyes and pulled open the door, sliding in and starting the car. Pause. "Don't y'all IEP phones save everything to the cloud, right? So, won't she be able to just download the pictures of whole ass niggas again because it saved everything to the cloud? I don't know. I'm not an iPhone person. But I thought everything in y'all phone was saved to the cloud, like, instantly or whatever. I don't know how that shit works. All you Apple junkies, let me know. Since you making me drive, I take it I can have it," she said. "Fuck out of here with that bullshit," Issa snickered. "Buy your ass a fucking Honda. Hoes like Hondas. That's why your dusty ass mama drive one," she shot back. Issa hollered in laughter. "Yo, she got one for real. That's cold. Where are we going anyway?" she asked, laughing. "I want to show you something. Just drive," he said, as he entered an address into the GPS. Why is mama really drive a Honda, y'all? Do hoes really like Hondas? Issa ran his fingers up her thigh between her legs. "You miss me?" "Not really," she answered. "Yeah, well, that pussy saying something different," he said, as he traipsed through her wet. He massaged her clit as she merged onto the highway. "Fast lane," he instructed, bringing his lips to her neck, tasting her skin. Tastes so motherfucking good. Aria's neck fell to the side as he feasted there. "Go faster," he ordered. His fingers pressed down hard on her clit and her foot pressed down hard on the gas. "Issa, you're gonna make me crazy," she moaned. "Your little ass already crazy," he moaned in her ear. He took a thumb to her butt and inserted his middle and ring finger inside her. She damn near lifted out the seat. "Yo, I promise I hit the fucking jackpot," Issa mumbled in her ear. His tongue was warm and wet against her neck. "Issa," she moaned, "go faster." Another order. The speedometer was at 90 miles per hour. She steered the car while he maneuvered her body. She bit her bottom lip and her eyes closed. "Open your eyes before you crash this bitch." He kept toying with her middle and kissing her neck. "Issa, I'm..." "Damn right you are," he said. Aria came all over his fingers, her thighs squeezing so tight that she trapped his hand. "Little nasty ass little girl," he teased. He leaned his seat back as Aria began, or sat smugly, smiling and floating on a high all the way to Flint. When she placed the car in park, they sat in front of a storage facility. "Come on," he said. She climbed out and followed him up to one of the steel orange doors. So I guess it's public storage. Issa removed a set of keys and opened it. He lifted the door, revealing tires stacked to the ceiling. He pulled the string that hung from the ceiling and light flooded the space. "What is all this, Issa?" she asked, frowning. "You own a tire shop or something? Pull that door down," he instructed. Aria reached up and slid the metal door to the ground. Issa pulled a switchblade from his back pocket and stabbed through one of the tires. He pulled out a gallon-sized Ziploc bag. It was filled with money rolls. He tossed it to Aria. "Shop with it or something," he said. Aria frowned, catching the bag. She eyed the bag. "You don't believe in banks?" she asked. "The money go to the bank after it's clean," he said. "Why are you showing me this, Issa? In case something happens, you come here and clear this bitch out. If I get knocked, if I get murked out here, you need to know where the stash is," he said, leaning against the walls and crossing his arms. Aria's heart stalled. "Is there something I should know? Something I should be worried about?" He shook his head. "Never that. You ain't never got to worry. I'm just telling you, I want you to be able to take care of yourself if something happens." "I can take care of myself without you, Issa," she said. "Nigga, when the last time you paid your own rent? I've been paying that shit for 2 years," he shot back. "Just because you pay it don't mean I can't. While you're paying my rent, my money's sitting pretty in the bank," she said. "Yeah, well, keep your little paper," he stated. He removed the key from his key ring and handed it to her. "You got access to everything that matters now, my name and my paper. That's all I got." The notion made Aria a little sad because Issa was worth so much more than he gave himself credit for. "That's not all you got," she said as she closed the space between them. She leaned into him, looking up at him as he peered down into her eyes. "You got me, Issa. I'm never going to need this key. If you bussin', baby, I'm bussin'. When they put dirt on you, they going to have to cover me too. You've got me." Issa wrapped a hand around her waist. "Real shit?" he asked. She nodded. "Real shit." She kissed him softly. Her touch held such finesse that it hypnotized him as she placed fingertips to his face. "I get real rough with you, Ali," he stated as he reached for her wrists. They were bruised. "I like it, Issa. I'm a big girl. I don't never want to be rough on your heart, kid," he stated. "I'm a fuck up. Always been a fuck up, but I don't want to fumble you because from the moment I saw your little ass, I knew I wanted you. I ain't trying to fuck shit up. I'm gonna get it right with you, and that's on my kids." Aria pulled her neck back in confusion. "Kids? Issa, what kids?" "Our kids, baby. Every single one I'm gonna put in you one day," he stated. "Like 10 of them bitches, all boys, because a nigga don't want no girls." Aria's tension melted. 10 boys? "Boy, fuck you. I'm not having 10 nothing. You'll be lucky if you get one out of me." Issa scooped her and turned her toward the wall. "Nah, you gonna give me 10 because you a good girl. You know how I get when you don't listen," he whispered as he attacked her neck. "A nigga get real savage, which is why I never listen," she moaned. He pulled back, staring at her. Challenge lived in Aria, and a man like Issa loved to conquer shit. "I swear to fucking God you're the best. Got my hair so fucking wrapped up in you," he admitted. "For real, Ali, every minute I ain't with you, I'm equating shit back to you, thinking of some shit you said or did or gonna say when I get back to you. Shit is fucked up." "Good," she whispered. "Control the mind and the body will follow." Aria was raised to be thorough. She handled men like men handle women, and Issa was hooked. He smirked. "You think you in charge," he stated, kissing her, pulling her bottom lip in so hard it ached. "I am," she whispered. Her body was trained for him, in tune with him, and he was screaming in need. Her nipples against the fabric of her denim dress, the feel of him hardening against her. She reached down, undoing his buckle, then freedom. He was inside her in seconds, and Aria's mouth fell open. "I want babies with you, Ali," he groaned. "Can I put a baby in you?" "Issa, no," she whispered, face bent in pleasure as he fucked her up the wall. "Yes, baby," he insisted. She grabbed his face tightly and forced him to stare in her eyes. "I say when. I'm not ready for that, Issa. And I for damn sure will have a ring on my finger. A ring that's been in place for so long that the skin under it is lighter than the rest of my hand. You got me?" she asked. He moved his head out of her grasp and then tensed into her slowly. "I got you, baby. You the boss." Aria couldn't believe how deep she was with Issa. She could have never predicted that the little skinned gangster, I think she meant light skinned, because she put little, wrapped in Gucci and ink that she'd met on a whim, would be the one to give her butterflies. He wasn't her type at all, but she had a feeling it was the reason why they worked. He made her so damn wild, so unpredictable. She had envisioned her entire life before him, and now she couldn't tell what tomorrow would bring. Their love was a spontaneous one. It was unique. It was aggressive and bold. He was hers, and as long as he remained loyal, she would be his. She hoped he didn't underestimate her, however, because if he ever hurt her, she would bite back. The exchange of pain would be unbearable. She just prayed he knew. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, y'all. That's it. I already drew the line under the chapter. So, I'm about to get up out of here. What you say, Nordic? Your ass be over here cracking me up. What you say? Melissa Ford drive a Honda Accord. So, yes, hoes like Hondas. Wait, why are we labeling Melissa Ford a hoe? Are we labeling her a hoe because she has friendly pussy? I know we not doing that. Child Nordic, I'm about to change your ass over here. Your ass gonna go from free Tory to yes, Megan, yes. And you gonna stop calling Melissa Ford a hoe. That girl ain't no damn hoe. I don't nobody give a fuck about Kanye West. Kanye West also said that Kim Kardashian was the epitome of womanhood. I bet you he's singing a different fucking song now. Fuck that nigga. That nigga ain't been right since his mammy hit the deck. May she rest in peace. No disrespect to Donda, but your son's a fuck nigga, girl. You died and you forgot to finish raising this nigga. Well, you didn't get the chance to because you passed away. Your son's out here fucked up. That nigga been fucked up from the gate. I promise you. No God. Mm-mm. But listen. No, ma'am. That girl got friendly coochie, and we ain't gonna knock her motherfucking hustle. I bet you that goddamn Honda Accord paid for. That's all that matters. It's the newest one, and it's paid for. And so we gonna clap for her. Right. Fuck all that bullshit. Don't let nobody make you feel like you a hoe. You decide who you give your pussy to and who you don't. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's all. Motherfucking men, is the men out here that was fucking her, are they hoes? Because if not, that double standard needs to change. Just because the double standard exists doesn't mean we have to fucking lean into that shit. Fuck that shit. Mm-mm. Because men don't lean into a motherfucking thing, including being men. Shit, they a bunch of fucking little ass boys. Little spoiled ass boys at that. While you bullshitting, fuck out of here. Oh, God. Oh. I missed this. Hold on.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
You must be a bush baby, Lawrence, because I don't even see you in the chat, but thank you for the Cash App. I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. That's what I'm talking about. I ain't even got to drop down in the chat box. Still send a bitch a Cash App. That's what's up right there. Thank you. And listen, I done labeled him a man and he could be at home knocking his bitch around for all I know. But thanks for the Cash App, dog. And keep your hands to your fucking self. All right? There's a little free advice. When she said, damn, Saki, you take shit to another level and it ain't giving that. Chill. I'm chill. I'm real chill. Yes, I'm real chill, but it may be somebody catching this on the replay that might have been giving that. And so they'll get the word, right? We real good. Ain't no problem, child. I said what I said. You said what you said, and we just gonna leave it right there. You meant it, I meant it. You just meant it different from how I meant it, but I still meant it, though. Yeah, that's it. Ain't no problem. I know you do. We all good. I ain't mad at you. Not at all. I'm not mad. I just speak how I feel. Y'all got to be able to. Oh, I should have told you. It's with a U, not a W. But it's cool, though. It's cool. It's cool. He had a U in his name. You know, like Lawrence Fishburne. Lawrence. But yeah. All right, y'all. So listen. I got some bacon calling my name. Okay? So I'm about to get out of here, child. Yes, indeed. It's about to be real good with what I'm going to put with it. All right, so listen, y'all. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud, okay? I appreciate y'all. Thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful, wonderful moderator. I truly, truly appreciate all of your hard work, darling. All right? I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTubeverse. I am too, right? Because, you know, you got to listen to YouTube while you're cooking. Shit, hell, some of y'all cooking while y'all listening to me. All right, so make sure you look both ways when you're crossing the streets, because listen, there are a whole lot of loose drivers on these YouTube streets. And I love y'all. I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one piece, okay? Y'all like the video on your way out. If you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. It's a good time over here. Even when I be fussing, it's still a good time. All right, y'all have a good night. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all. Thank you.